I have some handouts that I'm going to walk you through, because I want you to get a sense of where we are on this project, and of course, what the project is, so we are on the same page. My hope is that some of you will be interested in participating in this project in one way or another. So the first is just the handout, just the preliminary proposal that was brought to the Board of Directors. So my name is Paul Shannon. I'm the chairman of the board of Iris Oil Inc. And the board felt that it would be a very, very good idea to have a campaign we could all work on together. But the more important, a campaign that allowed us to get more out into the public, the public education. To get some of the information that we are not familiar with, the research and all that, the people that lets us get that information out there somehow, rather than kind of keep it for ourselves. So, the idea here of the whole campaign is to implement a coordinated national campaign around one of the four sectors goals, which allows different the strategy that we're focusing on is to change the registry from a public registry to a registry that is accessible only to law enforcement. Okay? This also does not, even if we've got this, it does not solve all of our problems. Like, there's nothing on civil commitment, nothing on the length of sentences that are being handed out right now, nothing along the lines of this new ideas of lifetime probation, of extended periods of probation. These are all major issues that would have to be dealt with. So this is not something that we can get passed. But what it does do, I think, is it gives us the opportunity to propose something publicly, a piece of legislation that then allows us to do education on general issues related to sex offenders, most of which will apply to the issue of whether or not they have a public registry. The next piece that I want to give you is the registry law. It's a summary of it, of a country called Canada. It's not too far away. You can take this. This is a law enforcement only registry, which is a national registry for a country called Canada. As far as we know, even though they don't have a public registry right now, there are not massively larger numbers of sex offenses in Canada than right here, where we do have a public registry. All the copies I have of that. I just want to hit on some of the guidelines, because if I go over this, it, thank you. Anyone else? This was provided us by Phil. So this is what a law enforcement-only registry might look like. The purpose of this act is to help police services prevent and investigate crimes of sexual nature by requiring the registration of certain information relating to those previously convicted of a sexual offense. And then it lists the principles that would guys carrying out of this registry. One of these principles is the privacy interests of previously convicted sexual offenders and the public interest in their rehabilitation and in reintegration into the community as law-abiding citizens require that, one, information be collected only to enable police services to prevent or investigate crimes of a sexual nature, and two, access to the information and use and disclosure of it be restricted to those with a need to know. So, in other words, they are, in this particular law, tying the idea of preventing sexual offenses to the idea of privacy, which is what we would want to try and move toward. Okay. So that is the present law of Canada. There are, of course, all kinds of efforts in Canada and between Canada and the U.S. attorneys, so that they will have the public radio's good law. But right now, they don't. They have this. You can read the whole thing later. It's not the greatest thing on earth, but in comparison to what we have, very fair and almost sensible. Okay. And they don't go to your employer, you know, they don't put all that information on the internet and all that type of stuff. So the importance of this, to the extent that it can be maintained in Canada, because there, as I said, there's all kinds of talk about changing it to a public registry. It was this to show that something like this is possible. That in having law enforcement on the registry, it does not endanger the public. In fact, those are the goals, to keep it private, if you read this closely. So again, for those of you who have, I apologize for not having based on that, we created a small group of about five or six people to withhold those people produce certain materials that might be useful in such a campaign. So what I want to do is run through these materials and explain them a little bit. Kind of what we've come to. We're taking it about as far as we can right now as a thinking group. And the group of adding materials. And we need to figure out the next step, which would be, is this something we can really do? What would this campaign look like? So that's the step that's key. So the next paper here is a draft of what we developed ourselves, which are model principles that we think should characterize in any type of effort in any state to introduce the law to every sector industry. And it draws some from the Canadian stuff, but also from our conversations. What are some of the key principles that we really go into in law enforcement only registry? So I'll hand that out. Now those principles are kind of interesting. Questions of who would oversee this? Who would this information be accessible to? Who would the police provide information to? And who would they not provide information to? We spend a lot of time on these types of questions, okay? Would it apply just to people who have already completed their sentence, including probation? Because if you're still on probation, this would not apply because they can pretty much give you whatever conditions they want if you're still on probation. However, people who have completed jail sentences and probation, then you're in a different category. these are the principles that we came up with. One of the key pieces of this is that the sentencing judge would impose the length of the time for registration, as opposed to being imposed by law itself. The judge would actually, in the sentencing of the person, would impose a particular length of time in 5-year increments or something like this. This is kind of along the lines of the need to do that. So if you understand what this thing is, then this, you can see whether, you see, basically, if this is going to happen, each state is in a very different place in terms of what legislation might be possible. You know, do we try for all of this at the same time? Do we do pieces? Every state can kind of make their own decisions along those lines. This is an attempt to kind of say these types of principles we think should be built into any effort, whatever differences there might be between states. Vermont has created a piece of legislation that will hire this group, and it only said levels 1 and 2. It created a tier system, which we had in Massachusetts, which Eric Tennant tomorrow will talk about is totally irrational because of the way they measure. It's pretty crazy, but theoretically, you know, those are the most likely to be offended. Those are the less likely, those are the least likely, and all this type of stuff. None of which matches up to what actually happens. But in Vermont, they were thinking of putting this in with the logic of saying, hey, people who've committed serious offenses are never going to get on probation anyway, given the way they sentence people. And so if we put them on a tier that says they're on the public registry, you know, what difference does it make? Because they're not going to be free of this sentence. And at least it would get off everybody else off the public registry. Well, we had disagreements about that. So these are the types of questions which we're going to get into in this workshop. I just want to right now kind of orient you to the work that's been done and the type of thinking that exists. Okay, I'm sure all of you have some really interesting ideas on this.
My question was, are there any states now that restrict access to it?
Not that I'm aware of, no. Not in the United States. But I think the United States and Korea are the only two countries that have a public registry. At least as of the writing of that human rights report back in 2003. But pressure is coming on all of them. You know, there's more and more coordination taking place, as those of you who try to travel internationally know. Now, the next piece is something that I put together. You notice what I just gave you in the Canadian bill is different from our registry in many ways, not just whether it's public. My sense was that the easiest way to approach this is instead of trying to get all these things in, you know, 5 years as opposed to keep all the laws in the state as it is. As bad as that is. But do away with the public piece of it. And so this is just a very short statement of principles of what that might look like. So this is an alternative to the piece that I just gave you, which makes it, I think, a little simpler, but you know, I probably have some disagreements with it. This is incredibly simple. All it does is it says that the registry would be overseen by the state public safety department. And each state would submit the same address information and other information as they presently do. Access to the information will be restricted to designated individuals working in a professional capacity the demonstrable will need to know. So basically, they would just leave every state registry as it is right now. People can fight out on that in terms of what information you give them. All it does is remove that one piece, namely, this would not go public. Does that make it easier to accomplish something like this? Is it good enough for us? You know, trying to deal both in the real world and the world trying to make it equal to our principles. So this is a very simplified version. Actually, what is it?
Paul, can I just
it so it doesn't go on the street to the registry. You would still have quarries as you would for any development. Actually, we're in a condition. In fact, you have a quarry getting given an item.
Public registry in the U.S. has never been shown to have a positive impact on public safety.
leave the candidates or anyone's registry as public? Would you feel less safe if you lived in Canada or England where the registry is only available until law enforcement? And I would try, is that a good argument? We're going back to 5, 6, 7 arguments here. So you can take a look at these, because it's kind of educational to ourselves as a way, as an exercise to go through to figure out what is the best way to respond to these questions. And instead of every time someone asks us this question, I see that research. I know I had a good answer last week. To kind of write these down on fact sheets, present them in different ways on the website and all that, so that we have these things ready to go and really work this to figure out what is the best. Here's another whole set of questions. Those are the first two questions. Here's the other two questions. We already had a law enforcement registry, and now we have moved to a public registry. Why did we move back to what we had before? Another question, how do I know that the information you tell me about recidivism rates is accurate? I've been told for years that these guys are going to do it over and over again. What is the best way to answer these? Okay, so here's another sheet here.
Nothing but it only was oppressive. It certainly wasn't helpful to the public before.
This is one of the first questions that like brought up, and I go, why are we talking about a law enforcement only?
Yeah, why did you just
get rid of
the registry
altogether and do something that's constant?
So can you talk a little bit like how you're thinking about that? Or
yeah. The thinking is fairly simple, that it would be totally politically impossible to approach a legislator and say, no, the registry doesn't work at all. Let's get rid of it. Completely. This lets a legislator feel, hey, I'm not telling you to get rid of the registry, okay? In fact, putting the registry in the hands of professional crime fighters, right? Which is, all of which is problematic. So it's purely a strategic.
And what about question. The conditions of the registry, such as registration?
Well, that can be, in the end, I'll talk about it earlier. I don't know if you maybe I can have one for you, too. Some of them change the registration thing to say it should be done at sentencing, should be done 5 to 10 year increments, that after 10 years are automatically off, which is the case, I think, in Canada. After a certain period of time, you're off, unless they come back and say there's a specific reason to give you one. There's always an escape clause. So, yeah, you may refer that particular model and set of principles that I hinted about earlier to one that I'm proposing that just says keep everything else the same, legislator, public, keep everything else the same, but stop ruining people's lives by having people going around, you know, putting up signs on their doors, putting on the internet, listing where the person works and all that type of stuff. These are strategic.
But are you saying that the same, like residency restrictions, presence, all those things would stay in place, you just wouldn't have anything with the internet?
The only thing we would fight right now is the public dimension of it. We'll continue our fight as RSOL against the registry in general, against unfair sentencing. Yeah, it's just an idea of how do we get some motion here, possibly even in legislatures, but whatever, to get the discussion going. Now, when we have these public discussions with church groups and stuff like that, we bring up all this other stuff. So people are aware, oh, we're on a registry, you can't live here, there, or whatever. But of course, all these laws vary by state. Like in Massachusetts, we have statewide residency restrictions.
By city,
but there's the defender's office is challenging that and trying to get rid of all that. We'll see how that court case works out. that would not allow any city to have residency restrictions if it's accessible.
You're addressing everything that's got to do with filtration and everything. So I just want to say that, if you're going to get attention, you go to the legislature, and present it, and I don't like your argument. It's like, this is not going to change anything.
It's going to take right.
The only other thing I can see that would get their attention is the money aspect. Now, if you show them that they can save money by reducing the registration down like this, and then present that and say, when you bring this up to the legislature, they're always talking about budget, so you can reduce the budget by this, maybe you can slip it in. And that way, would argue about it, because they're always saying about budget. So if you could come up with a savings and present it at the same time, because I don't know if there is a savings.
The problem with the registry is to put, gather all the information, as the point is being made back here, is what takes the money. Gathering the information, putting it into computers, to then just put it out over the internet is very cheap once you've collected it all.
But
you have to go through the hearings and all that in terms of who's going to be on the public registry and all that. So there is some money saving there. Where you really save money is it allows people to get a job and then they tax us.
And the box, you're still going to have the same criminal check. You have the box and people can, I don't think it makes any difference in the lives of people on the registry, except the important thing that maybe their neighbors don't know, but their neighbors still could find out, because you said this is a public facility.
But it does, because in Massachusetts, we get calls all the time. I have to get, I'm on level 3. I'm trying to get down to level 2.
But
so I don't have to be on the public registry. This is critically important to people. That whether it should be or not, I don't know. But people are desperately trying to pay lawyers and everything else to still stay on the registry. They still have to register all the time, but they don't. They're not on the public registry on the internet, and therefore they have a much better chance of getting that job. Yes, they still have. In Massachusetts, they have a thing, ban the box now. The Corey exemption, but obviously this stuff is still going to hurt people. However, it's a big difference whether an employer feels, if I hire this guy, are these groups going to descend on me and bring holy hell to the place where I work? That's a huge decision, in terms of whether I'm going to hire somebody. Or I'm a landlord.
I have another idea.
Is that my address of the building I own and possibly live in? Is this going to be put out on the internet, onto the entire universe? It makes a difference on whether those people will rent a place to somebody. But I mean, all these are obviously really important questions, and that's what we have to decide. We want a national campaign, I think, right? It would be great to have something that we all work on. Is this it? Is something else it? Is the home registry it? Is it residency restriction? Where do we have the possibility of getting some motion and getting a discussion going? Because for me, like I said, to me, the main thing is that we become a player in the national discussion about sex offender issues. How do we get that visibility and have a chance to get our arguments out there?
So in Colorado, the guys and ladies have to disclose when they go to their jobs and housing that they have a sex offense. And so it wouldn't make any difference at all in Colorado, because they have to tell people right up front anyway.
Well, that's true. That'd be true in just about every state. But the person may be willing to rent it to you if they feel that no one else is going to know. But if they do rent it to you,
I'm just kind of comparing this to an experience we had in Colorado with trying to get rid of the polygraph. And we thought about some different ways of doing it, or you're doing some similar brainstorming to what you're doing right now. And we were talking about perhaps asking those folks to be accountable the some kind of accountability system, which they aren't right now. They're accountable only to themselves.
Which people you're referring to?
They police themselves. There's no accountability system. And so we were talking about trying to have some kind of accountability system. And when we went to the legislature, there were a couple of legislators that really wanted to help us with this. But what they said was, you know, let's just get rid of the polygraph. Let's not mess around with doing a halfway job. Because my question is, do we really want to go out and make a big case for, hey, you still got your registry, when in fact our goal, for the ultimate goal, I know you want to buy some time, but the ultimate goal is that we're going to have to eat some words later.
Yes.
When we go back to tell people, hey, we did all that talk we did about, you know, that you can still have your registry and you know, keep people safe and whatever. We're going to have to go back and eat those words later. Back to get rid of the whole thing.
I don't think we have to say that the registry is a good idea. You know, in fact, our educational work will be not just about the registry, but about residency restrictions and how being on the registry affects all these other things and the impact on families and all this type of stuff. But then we just come up with a specific concrete step to take that we recommend to take.
I thought you just said that you would go out and kind of really play it up, that, you know, you still got your registry.
We disagree with you on the registry, but we're not asking you to get rid of it. You know, you don't have to say that I'm the person who's recommending that to all these victims groups that we get rid of the registry.
And if the facts are true that the recidivism rates are as low, let's say hypothetically this goes through, 5 years from now you have a non-public registry, and you go back and you look at the recidivism rates and nothing's changed. Well, now you have an argument saying there was a registry, these were the rates, a public registry, excuse me. Now there's not a public registry, and the rates have stayed the same. So the benefit of having a public registry was not necessarily keeping your families more safe, because things haven't changed. So you do have an argument to then take it to the next level if you chose and said...
We've got that now in states.
Absolutely, but I'm talking about...
Right.
But now if you took away the public registry for a period... And nothing changed.
I'm wondering how are you going to sell this? I've talked to some legislators, and they don't care what benefits SOs or their families.
But if you look at the answers to the tough questions, I am personally assuming that they don't care.
Okay.
I want to say, does this make any sense? Is this helpful to you to have this type of law in your society, and then at the same time that it has no impact on safety that you are claiming that it does, is ruining the lives of so many people, some of which you know.
By the way, in Texas, we were successful in getting the place of employment removed. That's what you're after. That's doable, provided that you make common cause with the business community, who is also interested in being able to hire people, good workers, and it passed because they were on board with it.
Arrested for a sex offense.
Okay, we can stop it. If they should be, then what do you do? Do you give them long prison sentences? Okay, you answer that question, but you move on to some. There are many dimensions to all this, right? This may be the one place to jump in,
yeah,
that some of you were saying. There may be something else that actually has a better chance of winning, or at least has a better chance of raising the questions you want. Or, by raising those more fundamental questions, do we isolate ourselves from the discussion altogether?
Well, this is always the question of any reform, right? Is it getting you in the direction you want to go to? Or as this lady said over before, are you going to have to step back and eat your words? Any your principles as well. I mean, every time, we're always trying to make some positive change. You're never going to get the whole thing all at once. But is this really moving in the direction?
Right.
And I think a lot of people, I certainly feel this way, I think I feel a sense in the room is maybe this is not, we already had this thing. The registry that we have now is historically based on something like this that they had for gay people.
Right.
So that somehow this is going to help the law enforcement community. You're keeping in place all of the things that people have to do and all the hoops they have to jump through and all the places they can't live and work. So, I mean, I actually think that this is counterproductive to the movement. I don't think it's a reform that's going to move us forward, and I think that it could actually step us back. And the other thing I would say is that legislators are citizens. You're talking about talking to them as if they're different from the public, and you could somehow go and make an argument to the police, make an argument to the legislators, and then go out and talk to people in churches differently. You can't, this is the same. They are citizens too. They are living in communities. They talk to their constituents. So I don't think you can make a different argument to them than you're going to make to the general.
Well, you have to make different arguments to legislators that agree with me on everything all the time.
You do, but you also, I think you make a difference in quantity, not in quality.
Okay, well, let's go into this idea. What might be a better focus of a national campaign?
Let me make a comment on your current situation first, right? Because nowhere yet have we talked about what success is. Right? So if you embarked upon this path and we got there in 5 years optimistically, right? If one legislator, you know, was swayed, right? That's a part of the argument that I kind of like. I'm sure there's guys out there sitting down going, well, I can't do anything, right? But I get killed by my constituents, but I want to do something. Right? Does this give them a little step? And if one state steps down this road, is that a measure of success?
It
wasn't worth the effort. Right?
Let's go back here. We'll go keep on going on, okay?
I think that the part of the problem we're going to have is that people are basically nosy. In our town, I live in Rome, Georgia. On Mondays, we have something that comes out called the Roman Record. And the Roman Record includes information on everybody that's been arrested, divorced, filed bankruptcy, to look these things up. The newspaper continues to do it because they sell Monday papers that they don't sell the rest of the week. The public is going to, because they are basically nosy, are going to object to the removal of this from the public information because they should be entitled to know. That's what the proponents of this Roman Record say in my hometown. And I see that the same kind of thing. Oh no, we want to know everything. We want to know every gory detail. We want you to list exactly what that SOB did so that we can make sure he gets the punishment that he deserves because judges are too soft. I mean, I see this all the time in public reaction, and I think the public would hang their legislators if they just took it away from them. It's one thing to get rid of the whole thing, the registry, but to try to take it away from the public, I think the public is
would they be more likely to
likely to want to get rid of the whole registry?
I think there's more of a good reason to get rid of the whole registry than just to deprive the public of the right to know.
What is that? What is that, Barbara? What do you think? What do you think?
Okay, so let's keep on talking, and then other people.
I absolutely agree with you, and I'm saying it myself. You mentioned earlier we are 86,000 in Texas, 860,000 in the United States. Okay, cool. Small number when you think of the criminal activities out there. What if you spent the same amount of time gathering public information and putting together, and again, this is way out there, hypothetical, putting together a database of every person that's drunk driving, every person that has B&E, and it's public information. You gotta get that information. Well, now you don't have 86,000 people pissed off in Texas. Mm-hmm. You have every drunk driver whose information is now public information and easily accessible, every braking and entering, and you go right down the list. Now you have this mass of people who are ticked off because they are being
exposed.
Thank you.
Lots of
so now all of a sudden, we are not just a single group of people being publicly admonished. We are part of a huge problem. And then the legislature doesn't look at it and say, well, we're going to not make the drunk drivers on this list, but we're going to keep the sex offenders. No way. They're going to say, these lists have to be stopped.
So we push
to get more people. We did. We push to piss off more people. And all of a sudden, you now have 100,000 drunk drivers. You say, what? Me?
Politicians.
Because in Tennessee,
they're busted all the time.
Tennessee has a meth registry.
They wanted to do the dog thing.
I say we label everybody. Put everybody on.
But you're right. And you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right.
The people that have not had their drunk driving license are going to have their family are the ones that want to be nosy. Must have hit their family. Yep. It's a whole
worse and worse. And so I agree with you. I think what we're doing right now is essential for
stopped, but, and I also get the feeling that these legislators that are signing these things don't even know what we're going through. I don't think they have an idea of every aspect of this that has been put on sex offenders, not just sex offenders. This is not just a, it's, you said, well, they don't care about sex offenders. They don't. But that's not the issue here. It's not the total issue, right? If we're going to emphasize anything, let's emphasize the families. The families that are constantly being hurt. You know, that guy can't move in, as far as his family go in.
Yes.
Right? So you're not talking about, you've taken one person and magnified it by at least six. All right? Kind of on an average. So if you're going to look at these things, we've got to look at the bigger picture so that we, and then we have to present that bigger picture. Because they don't know. And then, and I'm telling you, it's hard to in the pocketbook. That's why I brought that up to begin with, because if you can latch that on and then show them that they can save money, then they've got something to talk about. All right, so that's my...
So we've tried doing a thing in Colorado, talking to legislators and so on about the, you know, warrant drivers and talking to the SMB about it and so on. What we've been told is, well, you're the worst. You know, obviously the public thinks you're the worst, and that's why it's applied to you and not applied to other people. We argue with that. Nobody thinks that's correct. And the other thing I wanted to mention quickly is that if the victims groups are right and 80% of people have not been caught, and we're investing all of our resources in the 20% that have been caught, that's a terrible amount of money, public safety money and criminal justice money that's being invested in the 20% that are currently have been caught. And I think there's some advantage to using the victims' numbers, and I've been trying to do that lately, whether they're right or not, about wherever they get that 80% that are still investing in the home and in the schools.
It's 90 if you include all of them. 90%, yeah. And that argument is in these materials here,
right,
in terms of,
right,
if you want, if a person on the register lives next to you, who is the more likely, if your kid is going to be harmed, who is it going to be by? Very unlikely it'll be.
I would love to see this happen, but you know where we are in Colorado right now is that they're looking at going to a tiered system from a fence-based system, and removing the SVP. I'm on the committee for this with the SOMB, removing the sexually violent predator, which was the legislature made them put on when the Adam Walsh Act came in. And they sat down at the table, these SOMB members, and they all knew that they were producing a document, an assessment, which meant absolutely nothing. It did not identify anything, and so now we have, it's been done one time, and the legislature, the Joint Budget Committee, hired outside evaluators, ATSA people, really good researchers, to come in and take a look at the SOMB and the prison program. And they found, huge issues with what was going on, with the SVP assessment. And so we've got now 500 people in Colorado that are living under this terrible designation that have had two assessments done, neither of which the outside evaluators say had any merit in terms of identifying anybody that would be a sexually violent predator. Doing about it? They're not going to go back and undo what's happened to those folks. They're going to actually make a new instrument now until the legislature decides to get rid of the SVP and do a material system. So that's how these people think. They think in such a ridiculous, circular sort of way. I mean, we brought up on that committee the possibility of getting rid of the registry, and the cops on that committee absolutely livid, you know.
Yeah. So this is whatever we do, if there's any significance to it at all, is an uphill battle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sure. The question is, how do we get some traction? Maybe this isn't. Maybe does a national campaign help? If there is a national campaign, what should it be? Should it be on residency restrictions? You know, a lot of states don't have. Should it be on civil commitment? Everything. Different groups are going to be impacted, but registering to me, I got a 40-year sentence for child pornography, right? Plus, then I got 20 years probation after that. What do I care if there's a registry or not? That's the least thing I'm worried. You know, this is what people write to you, right? So wherever we go, the thing that's constant in all of this, however, is the ability to demonize a particular group of people. And the question is, what type of campaign might open up for us the opportunity to challenge that image with information and with experience? Because in this, you would obviously have videotapes of people who run a registry saying, this is what I did, this is how it affected my life, and you try to turn monsters into what they are, human beings, who are no different from anybody else. Can you imagine if we had everyone in jail who's ever committed something that's illegal sexually? I mean, can you imagine if the Texas legislature, the good old boys as teenagers, right? I mean, the whole thing is we start with the understanding that we're dealing with an absurdity. And we're dealing with a mysticism, right? You know, that has been in our country for ages. That hatred gets focused on different groups at different times. In the 50s, it was almost, you wouldn't even, homosexuality was unspeakable in the 1950s. It was just as bad as pedophile today. It was the same thing. It's just that today they focus on the excuse given is to protect children. Well, we all know if that was the goal of the laws would be different. Okay, so we know these things. The question is, how do we get out there into the fight and start to achieve some legitimacy? If this thing doesn't do it, let's get rid of it. But let's figure out how to do it.
Paul, excuse me. They want to close down around 6 o'clock. You got about 6 minutes.
Great. So let's take this. Basically, we're in midstream here. There's a lot of thinking about this to do. What I'm going to do is use these tests. It's going to take 10 minutes, not six.
Coming through here is a goal or an actual demand. that registries are bad. So I just want to, you know, put that in the thinking cap, because there is often more power when you got a simple thing. What's going on right now, which is another beginning point for this very important discussion, is that there are many different things in motion to reform and tweak registries, whether juveniles should be on them, Romeo and Juliet exceptions, ways off the registry, tiering, the amount of information that gets publicly disclosed, the type of public notification. And there are even some efforts about veterans and also the Boston Globe and ICE about whether enough people are on the registry. So I'm not hearing the counter, which is registries like weren't needed for a long, long time in any serious way. And why don't I hear that coming through?
And I have to say, when I think of the police ones to have this registry, I'm speaking strictly as a black woman now. I think you have the right to do that. Mm-hmm. I would pay for the police to have one of my kids on their registry, and next thing I know, they're shot for something, because we have to get that epidemic taken care of. This freebie of shooting backwards and forwards, I'm not comfortable with that. But I'd like to say that we have some ballot box issues going on. I would like to say that there are campaigns going on around mass incarceration, working with the returning, and I think that we could jump on some of those bandwagons, and an incentive to the government is hire a sex offender. If they've got to have a police around the area to whatever that their role is, drive around their cars, hire someone. And if that person's able to make it over a period of time, there's an incentive that's given to that employer. When a person has a job, I think that we can sort it out through those who are not going to be able to fit for an employee and those who are. And it also helps those employees know that this person isn't dangerous after all. It gives them their independence back. So we could tie into a hiring campaign. The government gives $4,000 for every ex-offender in Georgia. I don't know what they do here in Texas. If you hire them full time, we can tie into that same campaign, hire than a person's on the registry, and take away the edge off of the registry, and then let's not lock ourselves into this doggone registry, but let's move forward with something better.
All those are campaigns that people are working on. And maybe one of them should be a national campaign.
The beauty of this is that it ties together not just sex offenders, but every felon. It talks about racism.